So my PC is quite slow actually. Okay.
Trading connection lost.
Okay. So I need to make a correction from yesterday. Okay, we have this discussion. Okay, I mentioned I made a mistake yesterday. I used the wrong term. Okay, so when I we'll just talk about it from today. Under today's 24th, right?
Yes.
So I put the entire option sensitivity discussion, all this stuff that you see here. Okay, all this here you can see now. We're not really interested in volume for the day. I can just make this a little bit smaller. And is this open interest? Yeah, oh, I'm not interested in open interest also at this point. I'm more interested in delta, gamma, vega, theta. So if you see, we'll try to do is we'll try to make this maybe focus more towards. I don't know why the data is not updating actually. Try to go for a slightly longer dated option. Okay, so you can see these sensitivities now. You get some idea which we discussed yesterday. So delta, gamma, it's not pointing properly. Delta, gamma, vega, and theta, these are the main ones that we are interested in. So we'll get on to the discussion of option sensitivities. Okay, these are your crude oil futures options. Okay, before that, I want to just make a correction. Yesterday, what I referred to as autocorrelation, I put in the note in the video itself, at the bottom of the video when you have a note, you know, under the description. So, around 17 minutes and 50 seconds, I started talking about autocorrelation. Actually, I use the wrong term. I make this mistake all the time, actually. When I'm actually referring to multicollinearity, I say autocorrelation, okay? So the phenomenon that I described as the, remember we discussed these kinds of regression models, right? So where there's a correlation between the different independent variables. When the independent variables are correlated with each other, that creates a problem in the regression, results. So when we do regression, we assume that these correlations don't exist. When we are doing a regression, we assume that these independent variables are not correlated with one another. But when that happens, that phenomenon is called, which I described wrongly yesterday, as autocorrelation. Actually, that is the correct name for that phenomenon is multicollinearity. Okay, so autocorrelation is actually when the current values of a variable are connected to the lagged values of the previous values of that same variable. Okay, that's why autocorrelation. That's also another problem in regression analysis. So when we do normal regression analysis, we assume that these problems don't exist. Okay, so you should be aware of the technique that you're using. So this kind of technique, which you may later on use in industry also, this kind of technique assumes that these problems don't exist. So actually there are, if you look at a good statistics book or a good econometrics book, you'll see there's a detailed discussion of chapter and chapter on these kind of problems and what to do about them. Okay, so therefore you should be at least aware that these problems exist and these are genuine concerns in statistical analysis, and that these are the assumptions of your model. So therefore whenever you're looking at a model, you should always immediately be attuned to what are the assumptions of this model. Okay, and therefore you should also be thinking about how am I going to detect when these assumptions are not operating. Okay, this is one of the problems in social science models. In physics, it's not a problem. If you assume that the Earth exerts a gravitational force within its orbit, that assumption is never going to fail. Within the orbit, there will always be a gravitational force. So those are really, in hard sciences, this is an advantage. You can do real good modeling in hard sciences because you can rely on those models. Like the reason that these pilots are able to put the plane on autopilot and take a nap, have a coffee, that's because we know the science inside out. Okay, so therefore, but in social sciences there are problems because everywhere you're making all kinds of assumptions which are not necessarily going to work out. They are not assumptions like the Earth has a gravitational force, which will always be true. So therefore, that's why you have to be very alert to this kind of these kinds of problems. So I just wanted to make that correction. What I referred to yesterday as autocorrelation, that phenomenon, actually the correct label for that is multicollinearity. That is what that is. So multicollinearity means that the independent variables are correlated with one another. Okay, so this is just small correction from yesterday. So we'll go on to our, we'll just yesterday, because we had very little time on option sensitivities. So you can see here, so what we are talking about, you have to understand this in the context of the option model. And in the meantime, we can just make a quick trip to our graph and see. Despite all this tension, now they're saying the Saudis will take a long time to get the oil output back on track. Okay, not much of a reaction on the oil price. You can see that. Okay, so that's very interesting to see, because people thought this would shoot up to $100 and stuff like that, which is not happening. So this is another warning to you that this is one of the problems that what happens. You listen to a lot of people. I've given you some videos of I've given you the names of people like Jeff Gundlach, Ray Dalio, etc., to listen, to follow their thing. So you see somebody like Jeff Gundlach, and all, they do very good analysis. But the problem in the financial markets, which you should be alert to, is that the market doesn't have to be rational. Okay, so even if maybe you'll see Gundlach's analysis on the US debt and all that, concerns about the US national debt and the deficit and all have been going on since I entered the market in 1990. Even from those days, people were saying the debt is too much. Now, that time the debt was like 1 or 2 trillion, now it's 20 trillion. Okay, so, but the point is that analysis is correct. Your analysis may be correct, but the market may not give it importance. Okay, so this is the problem with the market, because at the end of the day, the market is king. If the market is not moving in your favor, you can't do much about it. You may be right. You may have like 10 PhDs and you might have done beautiful analysis. But at the end of the day, the market has no obligation. Hopefully, this is one of the things you're picking up when you're looking at, when you're following the markets in your projects, right? That's why I told you to follow it in line with the news flow. You remember what I said, follow the news flow and try to see how the market is reacting to the news flow. Sometimes you see that maybe Facebook announces very good results, but it's just because they gave a slightly negative outlook on the future, the stock price crashes, okay? But then next quarter, but you can't really rely on that. Next quarter, therefore, you think that, okay, if the outlook is negative, the stock price will crash. No, but the next quarter, the market may choose to focus on the earnings itself. So you never know what the market is going to focus on. So this is something that you should pick up on. Okay, like, I'm not telling you this. This is clear. You should observe the market and be able to figure it out for yourself. This is the fundamental problem with the market, is that because the market is not consistent. Today it focuses on this, gives importance to this. Tomorrow it will give importance to something else. So it's very hard to tell. It's very whimsical. The market is very whimsical. So it's very hard to tell how the market will react. Okay? So that's something that you have to be aware of. So we have a little bit of an interlude just to look at the oil price. I don't know why, even with the LAN, we are losing the connection. Actually, the LAN has been malfunctioning in the office also, actually. Anyway, so let's try and make the best of the situation. Let's go on to our sensitivities. We have at least open that. Let's see if this works. Right. So the sensitivities, option sensitivities, these are referred to as, we should write this here. These are referred to as the Greeks, okay? Like Aristotle, etc. Okay, so these are called the Greeks because these sensitivities are denoted by Greek letters. Okay, so if somebody tells you you're looking at some option software, somebody tells you show me the Greeks, what they mean is that they're talking about these sensitivities, delta, gamma. These are all letters of the Greek alphabet except for Vega. Vega is actually not a letter of the Greek alphabet. That's why Vega is sometimes also referred to as kappa and lambda. Okay, so kappa is the letter of the Greek alphabet. So but normally we refer to the sensitivity to Vol, we refer to as Vega. Okay, so and even then, even though Vega is not a letter of the Greek alphabet, all these things are referred to as Greeks. That's why you see that in a typical standard option display, they give you the option, the delta, the gamma, the vega, and the theta. These are the most important sensitivities. Okay, so we'll just restart this discussion once again. Okay, this is, you can see here, the idea of the sensitivities is nothing but what we said is we are trying to do you're already familiar with your sensitivity analysis, right? You've done this concept when you're doing Excel maybe or whatever. So sensitive, it's just basically conceptually it's the same thing. You're trying to see how sensitive is this option price, okay? The model output, how sensitive it is to changes in some of the inputs, okay? So when you're looking at the delta, you're looking at basically how much will the price change for a unit change in the underlying price. Okay, so the delta, this is already written in your notes, that delta responds to changes in the, delta measures the sensitivity to the changes in the underlying price, which you can see here is the underlying price. Okay, so the most important are these two, and then rho also, which is not shown there, but rho is not as important as these four. Okay, so here you can see some of these, all of these are inputs, all the things on the right are the inputs, okay, except for the gamma, which is the rate of change of the delta. This is important because, so in the gamma we try to measure the rate of change of delta. So if there is a dramatic change in the underlying price, okay, because the delta is measuring changes in the option, in the output, model output, for small changes in the underlying, okay, typically a 1% change in the underlying, okay. But if you have dramatic changes, how will the delta change? That is being measured by gamma. So delta and gamma are together actually, they're similar, because both relate to the changes in the underlying price. Okay, so one is the delta, because basically what does this mean? If you see, if we change this underlying basically to see how the delta changes, if we change this underlying to 101, let's see if there is a material change. No, I changed it to 191. That's why what happened is it went to us 100 delta. Basically, we call this 100 delta option. It becomes like the spot. Okay, so you can see there's a small change in the delta. It was around 5.533. Now that the underlying has moved to 101, okay, the option price has also changed and the delta has also changed. So when the underlying changes, the delta also changes. So if the underlying changes rapidly, there'll be changes in the delta. So the gamma is like a second order kind of measure, okay? That how will the delta change? So the gamma is connected to the delta. It is a second order kind of measure to show you, to give you an advance warning as to how the delta will change, okay? When the underlying changes rapidly, okay? So because this is only for, this is for small changes, the delta is measuring the changes in the underlying changes in the option out price to small changes due to small changes in the underlying price, and gamma gives you the measure of the rate of change of the delta. Okay, so you can just remember it as the rate of, that's what I've written here in your notes. Okay, that gamma measures the rate of change of delta. So it's important to understand here that, so what we are learning here in the option sensitivities model is that this is an OVM, okay, option valuation model, okay, which industry wrongly refers to as a OPM, option pricing model. So OVM has, like any other model, any other predictive mathematical model, this has a bunch of inputs and outputs. So we're going to use short words like inputs, outputs, instead of saying exogenous, endogenous. So it has a bunch of inputs and it gives you an output. And so if you change some of these inputs, it will change the value of the output. So what we are trying to measure in these option Greeks is along with the model output, along when you run the model with the inputs put in, along with the output, it gives you also the Greeks, which is basically giving you the sensitivities, the first order sensitivities, except for the gamma, which is the second order sensitivity. How will the delta change? So it gives you these sensitivities that if there is a small change, I'm just coming to you, if there's a small change in any of these inputs, how will the option price react? What will be the effect on the option price? Okay, so you understand it's not a complex concept. It's just like sensitivity analysis. Okay, it's a more formal way of doing sensitivity analysis, but the concept is the same. We are trying to understand how will the model output change if we change this input, or we change this input, or we change that input. Okay, that's the concept here. Yes, Paru.
Sir, last
week
you changed the price from 100 to 90. Which affected the theoretical price of call option to decrease from 9 to 2, I guess.
Yeah, it came down by $1, I think.
But today you have increased the price and again it has decreased the cost.
No, it didn't decrease.
Sir, it has decreased from 9 to 2.
No, it decreased from 9 to 3. No, it didn't increase from, let's do it once again. So at 100, with the underlying at 100, so this is what kind of option is this? ATM, OTM or ITM? Is my question clear in the first place? Yes? Varma, you have been away, for you're a little disengaged. You have been away. When you miss classes, you have to follow up with the video and keep yourself yourself in tune. It's not that you study at the end of the course for the end term. You have to keep yourself in tune, because otherwise you'll not be able to follow what's going on, because everything is building on previous elements of knowledge. So you have to get yourself, because this is quite technical stuff and you guys are exposed to it for the, it's not like very complicated like I'm teaching astrophysics or something, but it's new, it's slightly technical ideas, and you have to be very careful. And you're encountering these ideas for the first time. So if you don't, first you should be attentive in class, and then you should revise it at home, otherwise it will not get internalized, right? Okay, so my question, is my question clear? Is this an ATM, OTM or ITM option? ATM. ATM? Yes? Right? Because the strike price is equal to the underlying price. Okay? So it's an ATM option. Okay? So here, can you see, Parul, the model output is 3.019. Okay? And then I change it to 101. Okay? So the now it is what kind of option? Yes, somebody said in the money. You said in the money. Okay? So it's an ITM now. Now it's become an ITM. Is everyone clear about that? Yes? Okay, so now it's an ITM option. So you can see that the price has gone up a little bit. Okay? So basically, this is what the delta tries to measure, that for small changes in the underlying price, how will the model output react? Okay, so everything is for small changes. All these measures are for small changes. And even the delta, the gamma is trying to measure how the delta will change, okay, for changes in the underlying. Okay, so the rate of change of delta is measured by gamma. And so we are mainly interested in these. So you've got the concept. We are just trying to do a sensitivity analysis. There's a model here. It's got a bunch of inputs and an output. And we're just trying to see, by tweaking this input or that input, how will it affect the model output. Okay, that's the basic concept. So we call them option sensitivities, we call them Greeks. So in most option displays, you'll see these things being displayed. Okay, so these are, what do they relate to? So delta relates to underlying, gamma relates to rate of change of delta, vega is for vol. Okay, so here if I change, what do I mean by vol? Can open one of your other files if it's not open here. Yeah, it's not open, so let's open this other file. And all right, so this takes us back to our FX forward rate model. We'll just wait for it to load a little bit. Okay, we'll go back to what do I mean by vol? Okay, so here again, so you know that vol is one of the inputs. We'll understand later what it is. Right now you just recognize, at this point we only know that one of the inputs into the OVM is a vol input. Okay, so we'll figure out later on how it's calculated. So if you change, obviously, so because if it's one of the inputs to the OVM, then it makes sense that if I change the vol, then the output is going to change. Okay, yes, all right. So you can see here that if I change the vol, what is going to happen? What is going to happen? What do you think will happen if the vol, if I change the vol, what should happen to the option price? Will it increase or decrease? Up or down? Show me the figure. I can't hear clearly. Increase and decrease looks the same. Up or down? No. I'm saying, see, right now we were using 25, right? This particular price we got this price of 3.578. It is based on, inter alia, it is based on a vol input of 25, which means we are saying annualized volatility is 25%, okay? So this 3.57, now my question is, suppose I radically change this 25 vol input and I make it, let's say, 65. Now what will happen to the, now let's think about logically, okay? What is a vol? The vol is nothing but the expectation of, you understand what volatility is, okay? So sometimes, like if we really want to get into this, let's look at, hopefully we have enough weekly data here. You can see lots of interesting things here, okay? I'll use this opportunity to, where did I see, somewhere I saw even longer data set on oil. But anyway, you can still see this, it's got good data on oil. You can see we're talking about 85, from 85 onwards on the oil price, okay? So what we mean by volatility is that let's say we divide this chart into two phases, okay? Let's say around this, we take one as this kind of, we take it up to here, okay, 2003, okay, roughly, okay, from 85 to 2003, we take one block, and then from 2003 to today, we take one block, okay, if we divide this. Now, what I'm going to say is that in the second block, the oil price has been much more volatile. It's fluctuating. So volatility essentially refers to how wildly the price is fluctuating. Can you see that in 85 to 2003, there's very little movement in the oil price? It's such an important commodity. And in those days, we didn't have oil fracking in the USA, where the US was not the major, it was still a net oil importer. Okay, so the main source of oil was still the Gulf oil. Okay, and countries like Venezuela, okay, which by the way has more oil reserves than Saudi, okay, but it's a total disaster because of socialism. So now 85, from 1985, you can see it actually from before that, okay, all the way from here is basically moving in a 38, 40, you can say 42, okay, to 10, okay, so it's $10 to $40 for so many years. It's just moving in this range. Then suddenly you see, look at the next, so this is like 83 to 03, that's 20 years, okay, and 03 to 2023, the next 20 years, can you see that the volatility is much higher, okay, the price is fluctuating much more. Actually, this is, you know, if you look at the supply picture has improved much more in the second half, because oil fracking came into play. For the last 10 years or so, it's been in play. Oil fracking has dramatically changed. You can do some reading on fracking. Okay, hydraulic fracturing. Fracking is short for hydraulic. That means you guys are not reading, following enough market news, etc. If you follow enough news on the oil markets, you will come across this term. Because the use of hydraulic fracturing to extract oil and gas from shale deposits in the US has dramatically altered the oil supply picture, the energy supply picture, which makes the US now the biggest energy producer in the world, bigger than oil, the Saudis and the Russians. Okay, so this has drastically altered the supply picture. So actually now this should not be volatile. So it should not be so volatile because the supply picture has increased dramatically. Okay, but it's still, for some reason, it is much more. So this is what we mean by volatility. How widely is the price fluctuating? Okay, is this clear? Okay, we go back to our discussion of the option pricing model. This is also something you guys should look at. Everybody should have a login on this software because it's pretty useful. You can get intraday charts on Indian stocks, US stocks. Very good for intraday charts especially. But here you can look at long-term data as well. So another thing that you should also look at and think about is look at this market. It's such an important market. Okay, so actively traded. But look at the difference in the, think about this difference. Imagine that you had built a model for the oil price. You should just think about this. We'll address this later in a more formal way. Imagine that you had built it. This is a lot of data from 1983 to 2003. That's a lot of data. Okay. So imagine that you thought, okay, I've built a great model with 20 years of data. Okay. And you built a forecasting model for the oil price. Okay. Now, how do you think this model is going to perform in this future period? Do you think there are likely to be some problems? Do you think that the nature of the distribution seems to have changed radically? Something different is going on here. It almost doesn't seem like the same item, right? So the same market, okay? So this is one of the problems that you should be aware of when you're looking at markets. Because remember, this is all, I didn't cook up this chart. This is all actual data, okay? So this is what reality is. So this is something else, and this will be happening in every market. The only thing we don't know is whether the pattern will change dramatically after 20 years or after 2 years or after 3 years. And then again, this pattern can also change. This is also not guaranteed for the future. Whatever's going on now, the volatility, that may also change. Again, after some time, you may collapse back into this kind of a low vol. You see the range here, $40 to $10. Okay, very low range. And here you can see the range is basically around 25 to, this was 107. This was 147. I remember it was the height of the credit crisis. So it's 147, 47 was the high in the oil price. Okay, so 148. So now you're looking at 25 to 148. So look at the trading range. Okay, of course, now if you look at a shorter period, the trading range is lower. But so once again, now you don't know what's going to happen, because again, you might find that now the price starts getting quiet, and you know, it sort of becomes very, very subdued and becomes like this again. So you never know what's going to happen. So the market keeps shifting. So you should be aware of all these kinds of, because at the end of the day, whatever you do, whatever forecasting model you build, it's not something that you're going to publish in an academic paper. It is something that you're going to use in the real world. So you have to have a sense of how the real world, what are the dynamics of the real world, okay? So this is actually a phenomenon, what I've just shown you in visual terms, okay, is what we call non-stationarity. Have you come across this term? Stationarity is, this is non, so time series data on financial markets, okay, on asset prices and on economic data as well. If you look at economic time series also, you see the same problem. There is this problem called non-stationarity, okay. This is basically the data series is not stationary, okay. And then there are some techniques for correcting that, but you can't really solve the problem because the process itself is generating non-stationary data. So essentially this is a problem which really can't be solved, so you have to be aware of it. You just have to be aware of it. You have to be aware. This is a risk, basically. This is a risk factor. In any model that you're building, any predictive model that you're building, you have to be aware that the data on which you built that model, that may be coming from a regime. So these are called regimes. So you have a regime here. You understand what a regime is? Like, you know what a regime is? Yeah, regime is like rule, okay? So you had basically in Cuba, you had the Fidel Castro regime. Now he's gone, now his brother has taken over, so you have a Raul Castro regime, okay? So in Venezuela, you had Hugo Chavez, then Chavez left, then you had this Vicente Maduro. So now you're under the Maduro regime. So it's like rule. So regime, we use this in the context of stationarity and non-stationarity. We use this concept of, we say here there has been a regime change. At this point, there's been a regime change because suddenly the nature of the distribution seems to have changed. Okay, something has happened which has made the animal is behaving in a different way now, right? So this is what we call a regime change. So these are important words that you should be aware of. That is the concept of stationarity and non-stationarity. Here the series is stationary. If you just look at this part, it is more or less a stationary series because it seems quite stable. But from here, when you look at the whole data, then you see that it's not stationary. So this change from, and this change of the regime, the biggest problem in the market is that no matter what you do in terms of analysis, you really can't predict when the regime change will happen. In this case, it has taken 20 years and then we have already gone 20 years. There seems to be still a lot of volatility, okay? Seems to be still in the same regime. But you never know, it may just collapse again. The vol may collapse again. So this is something you have to be aware of, that the market is basically very slippery, very whimsical, okay? So whatever kind of predictive model that you build, you have to be aware that it's very high, it's at a very high risk of failing. So you have to be very conscious about how do I manage if the model fails. That is very important. Okay, so we go back to what were we thinking about, why did we get into this long discussion?
So we were talking about that if you could beat the volatility, what will happen in the...
Okay, yeah, so what do we mean by the vol? We were talking about if we change it, but first we have to understand what do we mean by the vol. Okay, so in qualitative terms, this is what we mean by the vol. The reason I think it's very important to have this discussion on stationarity and regime changes, okay, and the fact that all time series data on markets and even economic data, even if you take unemployment data, but we don't have a lot of data because we don't take unemployment every 5 minutes. We don't look at unemployment or industrial production every 5 minutes. Whereas in oil prices, we can take snapshots every 5 minutes, okay? But if you did, you will see that even that data is not stationary, okay? Because the forces that are driving all these figures, you have to understand, all economic data, all asset price data, it's all driven by the expectations of economic agents. Do you understand that? Why is Maruti setting up a new factory in Sanand? Because they have an expectation. It's not like God has told them that don't worry, car demand, I'll prop up car demand. They had an expectation that car demand would be very strong. So they said, because once you set up a factory, you can't just say, okay, let's shut it down. So it's kind of, you're kind of committed to it, right? So they had an expectation, they must have done their NPV models and made some forecasts, and they had an expectation that car demand would go up. Okay, so that's why they felt they needed extra capacity. Okay, now you can see what has happened to car demand. So that forecast has obviously not worked out. Okay, but the point is everything is driven. So when they set up a factory in Sanand, what's happening? It creates all kinds of economic activity. Employment goes up, ancillary industries get money. So GDP goes up. Okay, you know, energy consumption goes up, everything goes up. But you have to understand that the heart of all economic activity is the expectations of what we call economic agents. You understand? Maruti here is an economic agent. Okay, because a firm, Maruti is a firm is an economic agent, an individual is also an economic, an employee is also an economic agent. Okay, same Pulkit does declines a job offer because he feels another job offer is coming, okay, down the line, because he has an expectation that he is going to get a better offer, so he declines this offer, or he takes up this offer because he thinks nothing better is coming. Okay, so that his salary at the he thinks that maybe I can't get a better salary, so I better take this one. So that has an impact on average wages. Okay, employment, it affects everything. So everything is based on everything that you see in the economy, everything you see in the bank, in the financial markets, everything is based on one word: expectations. Okay, my expectations about the future, I expect that the Aussie dollar will decline, that's why I go short. Okay, that creates certain kind of impact on the market. Okay, everything is based on expectations, and therefore you should also understand that expectation is not some foresight that I can say with certainty that one day I will die. It's not, expectation doesn't have that kind of certainty. Expectation is just a forecast, like Maruti's forecast of car demand, okay, which as you can see has not worked out. So you have to understand all these things. Are you following what we are saying? We're having a long discussion without necessarily writing, but obviously that's the advantage. If I don't have to write everything, then I can give you a lot of, we can discuss a lot more topics. Are you following? So we have discussed now concepts like non-stationarity. I'm not going to put this in your syllabus, but these are very important things for you to be aware of. Okay, so non-stationarity of time series data, okay, and this concept of regime changes, and that you don't know when nobody can say when the regime change will come. If we knew when it will come and what the new regime will be like, then of course then we don't have a problem. But of course you don't know. The problem is you don't know when the change is coming, and you don't know what the new animal is going to behave like. Okay, so maybe the new animal would become even more subdued compared to this. Maybe the price action would have become even more subdued compared to this. But in this case, it has become much more active. Okay, are you following all this point? These points, these are very important things to be aware of. That's why I keep telling you to follow markets, follow the price action, follow the news. Try to make your own, try to form your own worldview of how the market is reacting to news. Is the market making sense? Because eventually that is going to drive your decision to use things like TA or FA. Okay, so if you believe that the market is not rational, if the market is not making any sense, then you will lean more towards using TA, because TA doesn't rely on markets being rational. Okay, is this clear? So we would come back to our discussion of OVM, but it's important to have these kinds of little, you can see that the one thing you can see also is that you understand now what volatility is. And the other thing that you should also be able to see that in any market, volatility is not constant. Can you see that? Volatility is not constant. Okay, so that also makes sense even if you look at your own life. If you go back, each one of you have had very short lives so far, but even then, if you go back and see, if you look at the volatility of your own life, where maybe things were not working out in some phase, maybe things were very, very much in turmoil, but sometimes things are working very smoothly, everything is going well, okay? So even that, if you see, that's also not constant, okay? So when there's volatility, there's low volatility, sometimes there's high volatility, everything seems to be uncertain, everything seems to be up in the air, okay? So that's the nature of life itself, that, you know, volatility is not constant, okay? There is always volatility and it's not constant, okay? So you should understand that if you just reflect on it, you'll see that ball is not constant. Okay, so when we are putting in, so what are we doing here? We need to understand these inputs, because these are fairly clear cut. What is the interest rate? Fine, whatever the interest rate is for 30 days is the interest rate. We don't need to worry about that. But this is important. This is an important concept that comes up only in option trading. Okay, it doesn't really come up in trading futures or spot or forwards, etc. So vol, we have to understand, what do we say when we mean, when I'm about to enter 65 as a vol input, it means that for this particular security over the next 30 days, okay, I expect the volatility to be 65, an annualized figure of 65% per annum. Okay, just like interest rates, this is also expressed as an annualized figure, okay, of 65% per annum, which means it's much higher than whatever we had earlier as 25. Okay, so what does that mean? I expect something like this, that the market will be very volatile, okay, very volatile compared to this where the market was not so volatile, which means it will swing around, the price will fluctuate wildly. That's what it means, okay? So we'll come to these measures later on, what exactly do we mean, okay? So is this clear now what I mean by vol? Okay, again, remember this is the, when you're putting in a vol input into an OVM, it's a forward-looking measure. Here you're pricing this option for 30 days. So you're looking forward to the next 30 days and making a forecast. So this is a forecast actually. Okay, when you're valuing an option, okay, we're not talking about eyeball at this point of time, but when you're using this OVM to find the fair value of an option, what you put in here is your forecast for the vol. What do you think will be this the annualized vol over the next 30 days? Okay, what do you think will be, you express it as a percentage, okay, 65%. What that means, if I'm saying 65%, which means basically, so the vol is actually the one standard deviation price movement, okay, over 1 year, which means if I'm saying 65%, that means what I'm saying is, you remember that one standard deviation is around, so we can keep it at 101, it doesn't matter, okay, we just, because I want to make it like 100, okay. So what, let's understand also what is the meaning of vol, okay. So this vol input that you're putting in, if you're putting in 65, which means basically that over this period on an annualized basis, the kind of vol that we expect on an annualized basis is that at the end of 1 year, this price, okay, over many iterations, 65% of the underlying price, okay. So that is the one standard deviation measure. The vol is the one standard deviation measure, okay, of the price movement. So this part we should write down. If we talk a little bit about vol, okay, we can write down here. Vol input, this is in your notes itself, okay, the vol input in an OVM is the user's forecast. This is very small actually, I should make this. Remember, user's forecast of annualized one SD movement in, if I write U lying is okay for underlying, yes, well, not very encouraging the response I write. So understand that everybody is familiar with the concept of standard deviation, you know the normal distribution, that 68% lies within the one standard deviation limit, 68% of the observations will fall within one standard deviation, okay? Then we have what, I think 68, what is the rule? One is 68, first is 68, the last is 99.7, three standard deviation, two standard deviation, 95.4 or something like that. You remember normal distribution also you have forgotten? Everybody has forgotten normal distribution. Yes, you've remembered, not very encouraging, okay. Saloni is refusing to engage with normal distribution. You're not interested in this discussion of normal distribution, okay. So normal distribution, just look up the normal distribution chart and just go back and look at your statistics book. So we will not bother with the 2 and 3 SDs. So the vol input, when I'm just trying to make sure that you have an intuitive understanding, okay? You should not have a mechanical understanding of things. You should understand intuitively what it means, okay? So we expect, when we are looking at these options, the, one of the assumptions of this OVM is that the underlying asset price is log, you know, the price change, let me not use big terms like log normally distributed, but essentially what it assumes is that the price changes are normally, that small price changes are normally distributed. You will find all these assumptions in your textbook. If you read chapter 15 and all, chapter 15 deals with the Black-Scholes model, okay? So you'll read all that in your textbook. You can read all the assumptions in the textbook, okay? But essentially what it means, I'm just going to simplify it because I think the textbook is a bit too technical, okay? It's too mathematical and too technical. It may be a little bit of a problem to understand. And nowhere, I don't think anywhere in the textbook, they actually explain intuitively what vol is, okay? So vol, when I'm entering 65% vol, which means essentially, this is my estimate of the annualized standard deviation. You understand standard deviation? Every series has a standard deviation. I can look at this chart and also try and do, maybe on the indicators, I can have standard deviation. here. Okay, so we let's see how, I don't know how this is going to work because it's somebody else's. Okay, so this is the standard deviation of this series. We have to make this is 20 observations. Okay, so this is the standard deviation of this series or 20 observations. So any series you can calculate a standard deviation. Okay, so you should be able to, everybody knows how to do that. You can just go and look at your formulas. People are not looking very, they're not responding very positively. They're looking like I'm speaking Japanese or something. Yes, Sash, you're familiar with standard deviation?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it's not something which is foreign, it's a new concept that I'm teaching you, okay? So there's a concept of one standard deviation. When you calculate the standard deviation, that is one standard deviation, okay? Which means that any data series, the standard deviation, one standard deviation means that if you run that process multiple times of 68, okay, 68% of the observations will run, fall within the plus minus one STE, okay? So in terms of options, what this means is, if I'm saying 65%, that means at the end of 1 year, okay, there's a 68% probability that this option, this underlying price will lie between 165 and 35. Plus minus 1 ST. Okay, so the underlying price right now is 100.
Yes.
Okay, and one standard deviation I'm taking is 66, as I'm saying the next, the analyzed one standard deviation movement will be 65. That's my forecast. Okay, earlier the figure was 25. I'm just trying to change it to 65. But what is 20? Even 25 would have the same meaning. Okay, so if you're putting in 25, that means you're expecting that at the end of 1 year, this particular price is likely to lie between 68% probability that it will lie between 120 if you are putting 25 instead of 65. If you are putting 25, then it will lie between 125 and 75. And since I am putting 65, that means I am saying there is a one standard, there is a 68% probability. Where does the 68 come from? It comes from the normal distribution rule, right? That 68, 95, and 99 points. I think 95.4 for 2SD and 3SD is 99.7. Okay, so that means that in the case of 1ST, we need to worry about only 1ST. We assume that the small changes in the price of the underlying, that assumption you will find in your textbook. The one of the assumptions of this OVM is that small changes of the price of the underlying are normally distributed. Okay, so infinitesimal changes. So that's why we express that as by saying that it's log normally distributed. Okay, so now these are normally distributed. So therefore, we use the normal distribution rule. And this wallet, the ball input is nothing but my view of the one standard deviation movement, annualized one standard deviation movement. This is what it means. And in terms of, if you understand it intuitively, what this means is that at the end of 1 year, there's a 68% chance that this thing will lie between the underlying price, which today is at 100, will lie between 165 and 35. Is this clear? Okay. Right, now we go back to our original intuitive question of that I'm increasing the vol input from 25 to 35. I've still not calculated this. 3.578 is the option, is the model output for a vol input of 25. Okay, now my question is, if I change the vol input, okay, therefore you can see the range is obviously much bigger now. Now we are talking about a range of 165 to 35. Instead of talking about 75 to 125, we are talking about a range of 165 to 35, right? Okay, so therefore, now my question to you is everyone clear about the setting, what we have set up? Okay, now my question to you is, what will happen to the model output, that the option price, that's the option price? Will it go up or down?
Up.
Up. Everybody's up?
Up.
Down. Tarun is down. Anybody else down? Oh, here Yash is also down. So that's okay. You're not feeling well. What happened? Not, you're feverish. Are you sure? You want to go home?
No, no, sir.
Okay, okay. No, you can relax. If you're not feeling well, you can put your head down and sleep. There's no problem. Putting your head down and sleeping is okay. Just that it should not be like, it should be both hands. Not one hand like this and one hand doing WhatsApp. Okay, so that's, both hands are required. Yeah, okay. So, now what was I saying? 65?
Down.
Down, up or down. Okay. So, Tarun is the only one saying down. Anybody else wants to say down? Everybody feels it will go up? Who are the people feeling that it's going to go up? who everybody's feeling, okay, why, Varma, what is the reason its score should go up?
So that range is increased, so with increase in price, the price is able to go up.
Why?
It was 100, now it's 101. And the volatility is increased, so the range also increased.
No, so but why should an increase in vol lead to an increase in the option premium? I don't understand the logic. What's the logic? Yes? That's your answer? Yes, yes, Tanya, what is your answer? Is my question clear? I want to see a logical answer. Okay, like if I go out in the rain without an umbrella, I will get wet. That's a logical answer. So I want something logical like that, clear-cut logic. Yes?
In that phase one, we saw that volatility was less. The price fluctuation in the underlying asset was low.
Not underlining asset. Underlying asset. Some people wrote this in the exam, underlining. Okay, underlining asset, yes.
So, in the second phase, we saw the volatility was high, the price...
No, you are referring to our discussion, of the crude oil price.
So
okay.
Expectation for the price of the underlying asset to increase or decrease will also be high.
So No. One minute. Let's make one thing clear. Our discussion of the crude oil price is not connected to my question now. This discussion was meant to just show you how historically something as important as crude oil has moved. Now my question here is just a plain theoretical question. It is not connected to the discussion of the crude oil price. Now we are kind of cut off from that discussion. Now I want a logical reason. I think Verma is saying that because the vol expectation, the price range is wider, therefore the option price should be higher. What? But I'm not able to get the connection. Some logical steps are missing. Yes, Tarun?
Sir,
but you are actually going lower.
Yeah.
Okay, what's your reason for going lower?
Sir, when actually it's increasing the volatility, it is increasing the range of the risk that the person is taking.
So okay, who is taking?
The person who is buying, going short, call or put whatever.
So who is buying, the option seller or the option buyer? Who is taking the risk?
Option buyer.
Option buyer is taking the risk. Okay. And what is the option seller, by the way, is referred to as option writer.
Yeah.
Okay. So another name for option seller is option writer, the person who writes the option. Okay. So the insurance company sells you insurance. The insurance company is the option writer and you are the option buyer. Okay. All right. Yes. So what are you saying? So the increased risk is for the buyer.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So risk for the buyer will increase and therefore...
Okay. That part, now I get your logic. Obviously, if the risk is increasing, then he is buying a more risky product, he'll pay less for it. Okay, fine. So this part is fine. Anybody else has an explanation for why on the increased cap? Anybody has an explanation as to why it should go up? Anybody has an explanation as to why it should go up? One minute, let's listen. You already had a chance. Yeah.
There is a more volatility in the...
We're not using the mic. Let's use the mic if we can. We can pick up everybody's voice properly. The mic is not working. Let's use the...
If there is more volatility in the market, then there will be more high volumes of trade.
Not necessarily. That also doesn't follow. Sometimes you have high vol with low volume also. In fact, many thinly traded stocks, one of the reasons I tell you to stock, I mean, it's not necessarily connected, but sometimes you'll see that one of the reasons I tell you to trade, if you're trading in the Nifty 50 stocks, I always tell you to trade liquid markets. Because in liquid markets, you'll have low slippage. Remember what slippage is?
Yes, sir.
Remember slippage?
Yes, sir.
Different between the stock price you set and the actual execution price, okay? So you'll have low slippage because markets which are thinly traded, low volume markets, they tend to jump more. Okay, in fact, the very definition of liquidity is, like you look at this, these the lots are 4 million, 2 million. This is quite small actually by foreign exchange market standards. Okay, London is not fully open. London is not open at all actually. I think even Zurich may not be open at this point. Frankfurt, Zurich are not open. You can see that these are 4 million, 3 million, 5 million lots. These are the very liquid FX markets, okay? Here, if you do even high volume, the price will not move much. That is the very definition of liquidity. The liquid a liquid market is one where you can trade huge volumes without materially affecting the price. The price, it can absorb a lot of the price, okay? Because you can see here, if you remember, if we had done, if you want to see some, what was the trade that we had? Book trader. Okay, if we want to just revisit our, you can see how, you can see the book size. Can you see the order sizes on the euro? Okay, in the, you can see the depth of the book. Remember we discussed these terms?
Yes, sir.
This is called the depth of the book. Now you're able to see the depth of the book. And this is basically the best bid and offer, which is the top of the book that you're looking at. Earlier you were just looking at the top of the book. Now you're able to see the depth of the book. Okay, so you can see how deep the book is. Okay, so that explanation is not satisfactory. Okay, yes, Taloni, what's your, is the question clear? Why should the price go up? Why should the call option price go up if I increase the ball up, ball input?
If the
volume
increase, the option price will increase
because the potential of the market has increased. So potential for what?
Potential
for
both call and put option. It has increased. And that is why
the whole stock price has gone up. So who is taking, you're talking in a way similar to Tarun, because although he's on the other side, he's saying that the risk has increased for the option buyer. Okay, you're also talking in a similar vein, but you're on the other side, you're saying it should go up. But you're talking in a similar way, but so let me ask you, whose risk has gone up? If it is actually true that instead of 25%, now the ball is going to be 65%, whose risk has gone up? The option writers or the option buyers?
Buyers.
Option writers' risk has gone up. If, let's say, then there is a lot of uncertainty that, because who has to bear that? Because you have already paid the premium. Remember the concept of sunk cost? In options, what is the maximum you can lose? If I buy this November, December, 52 days to expiry, okay, November, December, what's the underlying here? I mouse over and look at the underlying futures contract. Remember, in this case, the underlying is a futures contract. It's the December contract, okay? So December 19, the around $58, okay? The December futures contract is around $58. And I buy an out-of-the-money call, okay? Let's say I buy an out-of-the-money call at 2.18, okay? What's my maximum risk?
2.18.
If I buy car insurance and my nothing happens to my car, then fine, I've lost the car insurance money. That's all I'm losing. Nothing else is happening to me, right? So this we should be clear. So this is related to your idea of the sunk cost. And in fact, actually, if you change your mind about, and you can't do that with car insurance, but with options you can do that. If I change my mind later and I find the market is trading at 2.13, I can sell off the option I bought at 2.18. because I feel that I don't want this option anymore. I can change my view about the option. Okay, I can change, just like in spot, I can change my view, and if I've gone short, I can buy back my short position. Here I've gone long the option, but later on I change my view. I can sell it off in the market, whatever the price is at that point of time, right? Okay, so, but my risk is, in this case, I lose even less than 2.18. So my risk is a maximum of the option premium itself. That's it. I don't have any more risk. So this is kind of should remind you, you did things like sunk cost in your project finance and all that, right? So once you've already paid for it, that's it. Now that's the maximum you can lose, right? Okay, and then you don't really worry about it, but you try to recover a little bit, because here there is a traded market for options. Okay, you can't do that with projects. Okay, like Maruti cannot just take and sell its factory to somebody who's offering a bid. But so here you can do that with traded options. So basically the point here is, once you buy the option, the guy who is actually at risk is the option writer. Okay, so both of you are correct in the sense that risk has gone up, but actually you have to be clear that, so this is the connection that you also did not make, that the risk has gone up for the option writer. Okay, so if the insurance company is, always think in terms of, it's easier to think in terms of an insurance company. If the insurance company is writing insurance for some kind of risk where there's a lot of uncertainty, like right now what is happening in the Gulf, there's a lot of uncertainty because of the uncertainty in the oil price. You guys are familiar with the geography of the Gulf?
Yes.
Right? You know the Strait of Hormuz? Okay, you have the Persian Gulf, where all this oil from Iraq, Kuwait, Saudi, okay, all this oil is coming from there, UAE, little bit from UAE, Abu Dhabi, okay, all this oil is going through the Persian Gulf, and then there's a narrow mouth at the Persian, it's called the Strait of Hormuz, okay, which goes through the Strait of Hormuz into the Gulf of Oman, and from there it goes to the Indian Ocean, okay, so even our oil is coming from there, okay, so this, now because of all these tensions in the Gulf, what is going to happen? Freight insurance oil tanker insurance, all the rates will go up. Because the guys who are writing the insurance, because you saw one oil tanker was, two of them were attacked and one was seized by the Iranians. So there's always, there's a market for marine insurance. There's a very active global market for, because global trade and shipping, logistics, it's a very big business, okay? So you should be following this also. You have to follow every aspect of the global economy. Because even if you're in finance, you're not really involved in supply chain management. These things have an impact on prices. So you should know everything about what's going on in the global economy, right? So you should be aware of all these aspects. So because of all these tensions in the Persian Gulf, and they're attacking the ships in the Strait of Hormuz, because it's a very narrow pathway, right? So now freight insurance rates are going up. Why? Because the guys who have to pay up, if something happens to the tanker, the guys who have to pay up are the insurance companies, right? There's a very nice, I don't know, have you started your insurance course? Okay, so insurance is also a very fascinating subject, and there's the biggest market for insurance in the world is where? London. Okay, so you have all the major, all the insurance underwriting, even in the Middle East, in the Far East, is all being done. It's all actually run, the risk is run out of London. So there's a very, if you ever go to London, try to go and see the Lloyd's of London building. It's a fascinating building from an architectural point of view. It's got very, very funny, new kind of structure basically. So Lloyd's of London is an insurance marketplace. It's a huge one building where all the major underwriters, they're underwriting all kinds of, this is called underwriting. Okay, so they're underwriting all kinds of risk. Okay, so including stuff like this, oil tankers passing through the Persian Gulf. Okay, so all these, now these guys want to charge more because the risk is more. Now there's a higher probability that they may have to pay, right? So that's why they want to charge more. So same for option, if there is a higher probability, if the volatility is more, then for any given strike price, there's a higher probability that it will expire in the money. Are you following? Okay, now when the ball was 25, maybe if I was looking at a 125 option, the probability of that expiring in the money was very low. But now if I'm changing the ball to 165 to 65%, now the range is 1-7 division is 35 to 165. Now the probability of a 125, it's not the underlying, I should have changed the exercise price. Okay, so what we mean is this. So now for a 100 strike call, when the vol was 25, there was a certain probability of it expiring in the money. Okay, 100 strike call. But if I change, let's say 125 strike call. With 125 strike call, when the probability is, when the vol is 25, because we already know the 1SD range is 75 to 125. Are you following?
Yes, sir.
Remember that part, if you want to understand it intuitively. That if I'm entering 25 into the vol input in the option OVM, it means when the underlying is 100, it means that after 1 year, there's a 68% chance that the price will lie between 125 and 75. Okay, 25% plus minus, whatever is the underlying price. Okay, so if the underlying is 120, then you have to do, then the answer is not like 75 and 125, then it is 120 plus minus 25%. Okay, is this clear? This part you have understood? This is what the vol input means in real terms, in an intuitive sense. This is what the user's view is. I'm the user of this OVM right now. This is my view that it's going to be 25% annualized vol. Okay. Is everyone following the discussion? It's very important to understand these concepts because it's not explained like this in any book. So you have to make sure that the intuitive explanation you have to understand, because that is the most important thing. Mechanically, you can always do things, okay? But you have to understand intuitively in your head, what does it mean? So make sure you understand. If you have any doubts, you should clarify. Go back home, revise, make sure you understand all this, whatever is being discussed, okay? Because these concepts usually are not discussed in the books like this. So you have to make sure that you get your concepts clear before you leave your MBA program. Once your basics are clear, all the fancy calculations you can do on your own. GARC, volatility estimation, is just a technique and it's not really very useful also. But if you want to learn it, if you want to say I've learned a fancy technique, you can learn it on your own. I'm very confident you can learn it on your own. It's a technique. It's just like I ask you how to go and learn how to multiply matrices. You can take a textbook and learn it yourself. It's not a big deal, okay? So, but you have to understand the concepts very clearly in your head. That conceptual clarity is the most important thing. So is everyone clear now what the vol input means? If I'm entering 25%, that means I'm expecting after 1 year, this price is going to lie There's a 68% probability which comes from the normal distribution tables. Okay, that 68%, because it's a 1SD, it's an estimate of, it's a one standard deviation price change over a 1 year period. Okay, so there's a 68% probability that it will lie between 125 and 75. Now if I'm changing it, so if that, is that part clear to everybody? Yes. So now, so at that point when we were putting in a vol input of 25, okay, and if I was looking at a 125 strike call, okay, we can change this and see. Now you see this price will actually become very small. We will not, I want to just let it be like this, okay? It's whatever be the, because we are discussing theoretically now, okay? Right. So when we were discussing a 125 strike call, let's see, calculate and see how much it is. It may be very low actually. Yeah, it's very low. You can see the price is very low, right? Because it's almost, because it's right at the edge. 125 and 75 is the price, 1SD price change that we are looking at, okay? And you are talking about a 125 strike, okay? So it has a very low probability of exercise, okay? Because it's right at the 1SD edge. Sometimes you can have 3, 4SD movement also, but it's not what we expect a priori. In real life, it can happen. Okay, now if I'm changing this vol input to 20, instead of 25, now I think it's going to be 65. Now you're talking about a 1SD range of 35 to 165, right? Because the underlying is still at 100. Are you following?
Yes.
Now if I'm using this, now what will be my estimate of the fair value? Now it will be higher or lower? It will be higher, because now we are looking at the 125 strike call has a much higher probability of expiring in the money now, because the price movement that we are looking at is much wider. Okay, so this is the connection that you should have made in explaining it logically. So as you can see, if you put this here, you can see 00.002, this will, now you can see the price has gone up, the call option price has gone up. This is basically, what is it reflecting? So this is what you have to understand intuitively. Why has the price gone up when the vol input goes up? Okay, because you notice the put also goes up, both the options go up. Okay, the put price is connected to the call price by put call parity. There's an arbitrage condition. Okay, so no arbitrage condition actually. So so this, you can see it's gone up. Why has it gone up? Just like an insurance company, you can think of this example, if you ever forget, that insurance company is writing options when they're selling insurance. Now with all these problems in the Persian Gulf, the rates of freight insurance and marine ship insurance, okay, have all gone up, because these guys who are writing the options, now they are seeing a very much higher risk that there will be some damage to the ship, okay, or something will happen and they will damage the goods and things like that, so we will have to pay up. So if there's a higher risk of me having to pay up, I will charge you more for the protection. The insurance company is just charging you for protection, okay? So they are getting, if something happens to the ship owners will come to the insurance company and say pay up. Okay, so if they are going to have, if there's a higher risk that they'll have to pay up, they will charge more. Similarly, the same way when you're valuing an option, the option price will go up, because now there's a higher chance that the option will expire in the money. Just like when you're, when the ship is actually damaged, okay, essentially what is happening is that the guy who bought the insurance will exercise his option. Because the ship is damaged, now he'll come and come to the insurer and say, pay up, I'm exercising my option. This is clear? When you go and claim, when you file an insurance claim, it's like exercising an option. Okay? So what the insurance company is looking at is, what is the probability that you will be filing a claim? So if there is disturbance in the Persian Gulf, then there is obviously, in normal times, the rates might be at a certain level. But now with this situation being what it is, the rates have gone up. Okay, so this is what you have to understand. So you should always make the connection between insurance and the option market. Okay, so now you're clear. So now we should understand, we had a long discussion, but we should be clear conceptually about what the vol input it means. Don't just mechanically enter the vol input and calculate a number. Okay, you should know exactly what it means in terms of your view. Now this is, remember, this is again a fair value model. So just like Maruti did a NPV fair value model, NPV is an example of a fair value model, just like Maruti did a fair value NPV analysis before setting up their factory, okay, where they had predicted like increase in car sales, etc. Similarly, your, this is just a prediction. This is your prediction that the annualized volatility that will actually materialize in this market over the next 30 days is going to be 65% on an annualized basis. Is this clear? This is just your forecast. Okay, so you have to understand that's another aspect of this concept. It's your forecast. Okay, everything else is not a forecast. This interest rate figure, this you can see in the market, what is the interest rate for the next 30 days. This is not a forecast. Okay, so you have to understand the different inputs in the OVM, they are qualitatively different. Some of them are not forecasts. Interest rate is not a forecast. Okay, the dividend yield is technically a return expected on the asset is technically a forecast. Okay, because you don't really know what they will do. They may cut the dividend. Okay, sometimes companies increase the dividend, sometimes they cut the dividend. Okay, so you never really sure, but generally this is not this doesn't have such a high error rate. The dividend is not cut every day. Even if the company has a little bit of financial problems, they still try to maintain the dividend, because cutting the dividend sends a very bad signal to the market. Okay, so this is not so prone to error, but still you should understand this is just a forecast. Interest rate is not a forecast. Underlying price is not a forecast, because you can see it in the market. Okay, it's not a forecast. Exercise price is given by the user. Okay, so it's not a forecast. Days until expiration, that is also given by the person asking for the price. Okay, this is not a forecast. Nothing else is a forecast except for dividend yield and vol. Okay, these two are, and the most important forecast here is the vol. Okay, so that's why I'm calling it a fair value model. Essentially, it's a, although it goes into in our discussion, in our discussion, we have put it you notice that option all OVMs are put under AFV. Okay, and the reason for that is that when these option models are we can actually close this book thing now. I think it's just taking up space. All right, okay, all OVMs are put under AFV. Okay, because these prices, all these models, if you look at how these models are specified, how the values, how the models are solved, okay, so they use arbitrage free valuation techniques. Okay, they use the principles of arbitrage free valuation. That's why I put it under AFV. Okay, but actually they are not arbitrage free valuation. Later on when we see what is proper AFV, okay, that's why I put it under AFV, because they use AFV valuation techniques. Okay, but actually they are not AFV, which I'll show you shortly now, and you will further appreciate why they are not AFV when you look at actual true AFV, properly so called. Okay, which is this FX forward sheet that I keep showing you. This is actual AFV, because in this sheet there is no covered and uncovered interest arbitrage. Okay, this is covered interest arbitrage, where you have the modeling of the FX forward rate, okay, which is a zero profit modeling. But here the point is, here there is no forecast business. Everything is, all the inputs are known, all the input values are known. This is basically the difference. Okay, in true arbitrage, what, so there will be some other properties, but the main difference between arbitrage AFV and true AFV and you know, the improperly and forecast based valuation, if we go back to this here, you see, do you notice now that all these things that you did, all your Gordon growth model, your NPV analysis, you realize that your inputs were all, many of the inputs were forecasts. Cost of debt is not really a forecast. You can, even that sometimes we take as average forecast cost of debt, average forecast leverage ratio in the future. Okay, but cost of debt at least you can get from the market. Okay, but cost of equity is also a forecast technically. If you look at it, cost of equity is also a forecast based on, by using the CAPM model. So cost of equity, which is actually an input in, sometimes in the NPV also when you're using WACC, okay, and in stocks also if you're discounting earnings directly or discounting operating cash flow by WACC. So cost of equity is an input in these models, right? You remember, it's an input in the WACC. WACC, which is the WACC itself, is an input in the model, right? But the cost of equity, in order to derive that cost of equity, you have a separate model, which is, we can add it here, which is your CAPM. No, I'll just end. So please understand that the CAPM cost of equity, not K9. K9 is the dog. Dog units are called K9. The dog units in the police force are called K9 officers. Okay, so please understand that the CAPM, based on the discussion of models which we had, you all remember the CAPM cost of equity model? where you have KE is equal to, yes, Pulkit, what you said yesterday, KE is equal to, what is the first term?
Risk-free rate.
RF. Okay, KE is equal to RF plus beta into equity risk premium, RM minus RF, right? So here you notice the cost of equity, which eventually becomes a part of WAC, which is an input in the NPV model, right? Are you following? Cost of equity becomes an input in the WAC, which becomes an input in the NPV model. Yes, Shivam, you agree? WAC in the NPV model. NPV is also a model, right? Now, based on what we discussed in the definition of models, NPV has a mathematical relationship between inputs and outputs, shows a precise mathematical relationship between inputs and outputs. Okay, so if you change your inputs, the output will change. So NPV is also a predictive financial model. We'll show you how it is predictive. Okay, so in the NPV model, one of the inputs is the WAC. In the WAC itself, one of the inputs is the cost of equity, but in deriving this cost of equity input, in the CAPM cost of equity model, there what is the cost of equity? Is it input or output? There it's an output. Is this clear? When you do KE is equal to RF plus beta into equity risk premium, RM minus RF, in that model, in the CAPM cost of equity model, please understand that the cost of equity is an endo or exo? Endogenous variable. We discussed yesterday. Yes, all of you are not very clear. Yes. So we have done, I'm deliberately revising all these things which you guys have already covered, because these are all fundamental concepts. Your fundamental should be crystal clear. Everybody in the class should be nodding aggressively and saying, you know, like as if I'm playing headbanging music or something, should be nodding aggressively and saying endo. But I'm not seeing that level of affirmation. Many people are looking like me as if I'm a zombie or something. So, is everyone clear about this?
Yes, sir.
All the analysis, these things, these are all basic concepts. You should be able to do it with one hand behind your back, right? So, you should be so fluent in all this that what did we just discuss? We said that when you're looking at NPV is an example of a model. Now that we have given you a theoretical definition of a model, when you see a model, you should be able to identify it as a model. Okay, and in particular, we are mainly interested in predictive mathematical models. In finance and economics, we are mainly interested in predictive mathematical models. So NPV is actually an example of a predictive mathematical model. And so what we said is, one of the indirect inputs into that is the cost of equity, because cost of equity is an input in the WAC. And the WAC is an input in the NPV model. That part is clear to everyone? Everyone agrees? Okay. But one of the parts of the WAC is the cost of equity. Right? One of the parts, if you look at the WAC model also. Now, when you write WAC is equal to percentage debt into cost of debt plus percentage equity into cost of equity, in that model, WAC is endo or exo?
Endo.
Somebody said exo just now, but in that model the WAC is the endo?
Yes, sir.
Is that clear? So it should be these. I'm deliberately rehashing all these concepts so that it should be very, so everything should be crystal clear in your head. Just like when we used to memorize multiplication tables in school, we used to keep on revising. Then you don't have to, once you memorize it a few times, then it's automatically in your brain. Okay, yeah, here I don't want you to memorize, but I want you to go through the exercise repeatedly so that you understand clearly. Is this clear? Yes? Okay. So, people are getting restless. Yash has woken up. We have just 1 more minute to go. 1 minute. So, we at least let's clarify this concept clearly. Okay. So, now once again check that. Okay. WAC is an, in the WAC model, WAC is equal to cost of debt into percentage debt plus cost of equity into percentage equity. WAC is an endogenous variable. Yes? Now, in the WAC model, cost of equity is what? Endo or exo?
Exo.
Cost of equity is an exogenous model in the, is exogenous variable in the WAC model.
Yes, sir.
Okay? But then cost of equity itself in the CAPM KE model is a
endo.
Okay? So you should be clear about all these things so that we, you know, you are, these fundamentals should be 100% clear. Then we'll further continue on this. And we still have 1 minute. We have Okay, let's keep some of this on so that we have a... Alright, okay. So, what were we discussing? We were just... So, all we managed to discuss is that if the vol input... You understand now what the vol input is? And if the vol input goes up, the option price will go up. Now you know why. Okay? Okay, fine. Whatever we've covered, at least you should have understood that. If you've understood that, then the class is successful. Okay? Okay. So, those who are sleeping, please go home and revise. Okay? Yeah. Technical question.
In a similar way, we have a question that the volatility will go up and the option price will go up. You said in Black-Scholes model, call option is directly proportional to volatility. So
both if, calls and puts.
Yes. So if call option, if volatility is high, that means our underlying stock is high. So that means our call option is, will go up.
What did you say just now?
I said.
Give her the mic. Give her the mic. Let's capture it properly. Now, what you just, I just disagree with your last statement. You said something about if the ball is high, the underlying price is high.
The underlying stock price will be high.
No. That statement is not a correct statement. If the ball is high, the underlying stock price will be high. That's not correct.
But the simpler answer to this, if it is directly proportional call option and volatility, so if volatility is high, then call option will be high. So eventually,
yeah. So simpler. It just says in terms of the English language, the use of the language, I'm just objecting to what you said in the last statement. That if the volatility is high, then the underlying price will be high. That's not a good way of stating it. Maybe I think you understood what you what we have discussed, but the way you should state this is that if the vol is high, if the estimate of the vol is going up, okay, this input in the vol into the OVM, this input of vol into the OVM is nothing but the user's model, user's estimate of the what vol will happen in the future, okay, what vol will materialize, okay. So all that means is that if the vol has gone up dramatically, the vol estimate, that means that the probability of the price moving in wide ranges has gone up, both sides, up or down. So that's why I'm objecting to your statement. Just seems to be emphasizing only the upside potential, and also it's not very well worded. That's all. But essentially, this is what it means. That now, same thing. If you vol is what? Vol is just the one standard deviation, is what annualized one standard deviation, price change. Okay. So vol is the estimate of the one annualized one standard deviation price change. So the moment you increase it from 25 to 65, now you're talking, there's a 68% chance that it will the price will be between 35 and 165 instead of 75 and 125. So you have increased the range of same 68% probability applies to a much wider range. So therefore, any given option with, let's say, a strike price of 125, now there's a higher chance that it will finish in the money. So that person who's selling the option has to, therefore, there will be exercised, like if the ship is damaged in the Strait of Hormuz, the guys will come to claim from the insurer. So if there's, I think there's a higher chance that a claim will be filed, which is the same thing as exercising the option. Okay, then obviously I want to charge higher for it, because if the claim is filed, I have to pay out, right? So this is the logic, basically. This is how you should understand it. Yeah.
So, sir,
since,
I give you a simple explanation.
That is not. No, yourself. I understand your desire to get it, but your use of the English language is not a perfect use of the language. That's why I said, because you seem to be emphasizing the upside potential only.
Yeah.
It will apply to puts also, both sides. So you really have to talk about a wider range of movements that is now possible. That's all. Right?
So this logic is not wrong.
No, logic is not wrong. As long as you have understood it the way that I have explained it. Okay? Because the problem with what you were saying is that you seem to be emphasizing the upside potential. You have to look at both sides, because put option prices also go up. Because of now the whole range is wider, right?
Okay. Yes, yeah. A similar question.
Yeah. Where's the mic?
So this is a small thing.
Increase
in the volatility.
Yeah.
Then call price will also increase and put option will also increase.
Yes, that's what you saw.
But
we weren't focusing on the put price. Visually, we were not focusing.
Earlier, the call option was 3.578, but now it is 1.212. So the call.
No. Actually, we have to keep the strike constant. You may have looked at it from the. Now look at it this way, okay? Let's do the reverse now. Now look at 125 exercise. Okay, 125 exercise price, you got all these values. Now note down the call and puts now 1.212
and
25.781. Okay, now I'll do it the other way. Have we done it for one? Actually, did we do it for 65? I don't think we did it for 65. Yeah, it is for 65. Okay, 1.212, 25. Now let's increase, let's decrease it, let's take it back to 25. Okay, both have gone down. The call has gone down a lot, okay, because this exercise price, but the put has also gone down a little bit. You can really see the impact if you want to see it, if you want to see the differential impact. Let's keep the strike and add the money. Okay, now you've got 25, let's calculate for add the money. Now you see 3.019, 2.691. You can do the exercise at home also, but we'll do it here for the sake of the class. Okay, now 3.01 and 2.691. Now I'm going to increase the ball to 65. Okay, now you see what happens to both prices. Okay, because the probability has gone up both sides. Now you're just looking at a wider range. So earlier, if you now looked at like a 90 put at a 25% ball, the 90 put had a certain probability of exercise. But now if you bring the ball to 65, now we're talking about 35 to 165. So that 90 put has a much higher probability of exercise. So then that means it's like a ship airline riding insurance at Lloyd's of London, and the Iranians have started misbehaving. So now there's a higher chance that the ships will get hit. So if I'm riding insurance for a ship damage, there's a higher chance that people will come to me for claims. So I'm going to charge a higher premium. So if you understand this logically, then you'll never forget it once you understand conceptually. Clear? Okay. Now we'll close it. Yes, Ganotra, you have a conceptual question?